So now we are going to discuss about vascular injuries of the brain. What are the vascular injuries of the brain? So what are the vascular injuries of the brain? We can divide them into four types, right? It can be four types of brain hemorrhage or vascular injury. Number one is epidural hemorrhage or hematoma, right? So number one is epidural hemorrhage. Number two is subdural hemorrhage, right? So epidural, subdural, and third is the intraparenchymal or intracerebral hemorrhage, right? So intraparenchymal or intracerebral hemorrhage, right? Fourth one is subarachnoid hemorrhage. So fourth is subarachnoid hemorrhage. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, right? So these are four types of the brain hemorrhages which we can see in trauma. Out of these four, which is most common type, right? So here I would like to tell you, because students, they get confusion between subarachnoid versus intracerebral hemorrhage. To understand this, what we should focus on, what is the most common cause of the subarachnoid hemorrhage, right? So one by one we can learn, okay, what is the most common cause of subarachnoid hemorrhage? So what is the most common cause of subarachnoid hemorrhage? What is the most common cause of subarachnoid hemorrhage? So most common cause of subarachnoid hemorrhage is the trauma, right? So most common cause of subarachnoid hemorrhage is the trauma, right? So after the trauma, second most common is the Barry's aneurysm rupture. Barry's aneurysm rupture. So Barry's aneurysm rupture is the second most common cause of the brain hemorrhage, subarachnoid hemorrhage, right? So these are the two causes. Intracerebral hemorrhage, most common cause is hypertension. So hypertension is the most common cause of intracerebral hemorrhage. So now you can easily make it out, okay, what is more common, right? Simple thing, physical trauma is most common or mental trauma is most common? Hypertension, because of the mental trauma, right? So we have to understand this point. Hypertension is more commoner than trauma. So that is why when examiner asks you what is the most common type of intracerebral hemorrhage, so we have to remember intracerebral hemorrhage is the most common type of brain hemorrhage. Most common type of brain hemorrhage. This was the All India question in 2015. It's a repeat question. Remember, this is very often asked question in exam. Most common type of brain hemorrhage is intraparenchymal or intracerebral hemorrhage because of hypertension, right? So these things we have to keep in mind. So overall, now we understood what is the most common hemorrhage, brain hemorrhage is the intracerebral. So most common brain hemorrhage is the intracerebral hemorrhage, right? And hypertension is the most common cause. Coming back to the comparison between epidural and subdural hemorrhages, now we are going to compare these two first, then we will come to the next two, right? So epidural and subdural hemorrhage, it's basically because of the trauma, right? And now we will see what is the nature of this hemorrhage by seeing the diagram of the brain. Suppose I am showing you, this is the brain tissue, right? So this is the brain tissue I am showing you, right? Brain is covered by dura mater, right? So suppose this green color, what I am drawing here is the dura mater. So this is the green color is the dura mater, right? Dura mater, and overlying dura mater there is a scalp bone, right? So this is the bone, right? So this is the bone, right? So there is a bone, dura mater, brain, right? Brain brain surface is having cortical bridging vein, right? So brain surface is having cortical bridging veins. So cortical bridging veins are present on the surface of the brain, and there is a middle meningeal artery which is running through the dura mater and the bony part of the skull, right? So I'm showing you, this is the blood vessel, right? So this is the blood vessel which is the middle meningeal artery, right? So this is the middle meningeal artery, middle meningeal artery, right, which I will be writing in short MMA, middle meningeal artery, right? So middle meningeal artery is going through between the space between the bone and the dura mater, right? Bone and dura mater. So whenever there is a rupture of this middle meningeal artery, whenever there is a rupture of middle meningeal artery, what will happen? Blood will be accumulated here, right? Blood will be accumulated here, and because of that, now the dura mater will be pushed inward like this, right? So now the dura mater is going like this, and blood is getting collection over the dura mater. So what is this called as? It is above the dura, right? So you can see the blood, this hemorrhage is above the dura. So what I'm showing you, this hemorrhagic mass is above the dura. That is why it is called as epidural hemorrhage. So that is why it is called as epidural hemorrhage. So what we are coming to know, that epidural hemorrhage is because of rupture of middle meningeal artery, right? So it is due to rupture of, so epidural hemorrhage. So now we have to understand this point. Epidural hemorrhage is due to rupture of middle meningeal artery, right? So it is due to rupture of middle meningeal artery. There is a epidural hemorrhage. There is a blood collection. So what kind of blood it will be? Obviously it is artery. So it is arterial blood, right? So epidural hemorrhage is the arterial blood, right? So these are arterial blood, right? So that is why I had made in red color, arterial blood, right? But when there is a rupture of the cortical bridging vein over the surface of the brain, because of the rupture of the cortical bridging vein, there will be collection of the blood here. So these are venous blood. Can you see the color I had made as the blue? So these are the venous blood because of rupture of the cortical bridging vein, and these are below the dura mater. So that is why it is subdural hemorrhage, right? So subdural hemorrhage is below the dura, and it is due to rupture of which artery? Cortical bridging vein. It is due to rupture of cortical bridging vein. So that is the important thing between these two, epidural hemorrhage versus subdural hemorrhage. Epidural hemorrhage is arterial bleed, subdural is venous. Who is more dangerous? Epidural is more dangerous because there will be more blood loss, arterial blood flow is faster, more dangerous, so they will require emergency treatment, right? So epidural will be having requirement for emergency treatment. So emergency craniotomy will be required to remove the pressure of the blood on the overlying brain and dura mater, right? So emergency craniotomy will be required for these patients, right? Cortical bridging vein in comparison to this is not that harmful, and both will be having lucid interval. So here another important point which we should remember, there is a called interval, lucid interval. There is a lucid interval. Lucid interval will be seen in both of them. So remember, it will be seen in epidural hemorrhage also. It will be seen in subdural hemorrhage also, right? But here we have to understand, lucid interval is prolonged and characteristic in case of epidural hemorrhage. So if examiner says it is characteristic and prolonged in case of epidural hemorrhage. What is lucid interval? Lucid interval is period of consciousness between two unconsciousness, right? So it's a period of consciousness. So what I'm showing you here, suppose a patient has come, he was unconscious, then he became conscious, and after that again he became unconscious. After that again he became unconscious, right? So this duration of consciousness between two unconsciousness is called as lucid interval. So remember, this period of consciousness between two unconsciousness is called as lucid interval, right? So that point also we have to keep in mind. Period of consciousness between two unconscious is called as lucid interval, and this will be more prolonged and characteristic for epidural hemorrhages, right? So these are important point about epidural hemorrhage. Coming to the intracerebral hemorrhage. Intracerebral hemorrhage, as we have learned, hypertension is the most common cause, right? Now we are going to learn what will be the most common site for intracerebral hemorrhage. So what will be the most common site for intracerebral hemorrhage? Most common site for intracerebral hemorrhage will be middle cerebral artery. Middle cerebral artery is the most common site. That is another interesting question in exam. Middle cerebral artery, which branch? So remember, middle cerebral artery, lenticulostriate branch. Lenticulostriate branch. So lenticulostriate branch is the most common site. So most common site for intracerebral hemorrhage is, most common site for intracerebral hemorrhage is the middle cerebral artery or lenticulostriate branch of the middle cerebral artery. What is the pathology in this hypertensive bleeding? That was the older question in All India exam. So when you discuss about the pathogenesis, what will be the pathogenesis? So I would like to describe this pathogenesis by giving this example. Right, suppose I am showing you this blood vessel, and in this blood vessel what we are observing there is a hypertension, and because what is the reason for hypertension? More amount of the lipid and more amount of the hyalin which is running through the blood, right? So lipid and hyaline, they are abundant in our blood during hypertensive phase, and repeated damage by lipid and hyalin on the blood vessel wall. See, lipid and hyalin, they are along with the blood flow consistently, they are damaging the blood vessel, and because of that blood vessel wall will be having dilatation. So this condition is called as lipohyalinosis. So this condition is called as lipohyalinosis. So because of lipohyalinosis, what will happen? Lipid and hyaline will be deposited. Now we can see the vessel wall has been dilated, and we all know that vessel wall dilation is called as aneurysm. So this is called aneurysm. So lipohyalinosis is causing aneurysm. So this lipohyalinosis is causing blood vessel wall dilation, which is known as aneurysm, right? So blood vessel wall dilation is called as aneurysm, right? So this is aneurysm. What kind of aneurysm it is? What is the name of hypertensive aneurysm? Hypertensive aneurysm in the brain is known as Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm. So this aneurysm is known as Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm. So this is called as Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm. So that is another important MCQ in exam, right? Hypertensive brain will be having which aneurysm? Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm. This Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm is prone for the rupture and bleeding, right? So this Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm will show rupture, right? So now they will be having rupture, right? So because of rupture, they will have intracranial bleed, right? So this is the reason for IC bleeding, intracranial bleeding. So in hypertension, what we have learned, middle cerebral artery, lenticulostriate branch is the most common site. Lipohyalinosis is the pathology. Aneurysm is the Charcot-Bouchard aneurysm. And when they will be having bleeding, so what will be the most common site of the bleeding in hypertension? So that is another important and frequently asked MCQ in exam. Most common site for hypertensive bleed. Most common site for hypertensive bleed, right? So what is the most common site for hypertensive bleed? So they will be having, that will be basal ganglia, right? So this was the AIIMS question in 2015. Basal ganglia, this is the old repeat MCQ, right? Basal ganglia, right? So this answer was basal ganglia, but older MCQs which examiner used to ask, which nucleus of the basal ganglia is the most common site? Putamen, right? So in basal ganglia also, what is most common site? In basal ganglia also, most common site is the putamen, right? So this is the most common site for intracranial hemorrhage. So most common site for bleeding is the putamen, right? So putamen is the most common site for the intracranial bleeding of hypertensive bleed. Now, what I want to tell you, there was a question in NIMHANS exam 2015. Because of this repeated episodes of the hypertensive bleed, right? Right? So what I'm saying, repeated episodes of the intracranial bleeding. Repeated episodes of hypertensive bleeding. Right? So because of the repeated episodes of the hypertensive bleed, patient will develop hypertensive encephalopathy. Right, patient will develop hypertensive encephalopathy, and because of hypertensive encephalopathy, they will develop dementia. Right, and that was the question. What is name of this dementia? Hypertensive encephalopathy, what is the name of dementia? So name of this dementia is Binswanger disease. This is called as Binswanger disease or syndrome, right? So Binswanger disease or Binswanger syndrome is the hypertensive encephalopathy causing dementia, right? So hypertensive encephalopathy leading to dementia is called as Binswanger disease, right? So that is the question which examiner had asked in NIMHANS exam, and this is the older AIIMS All India question also. Hypertensive encephalopathy, name of the dementia is Binswanger dementia. Right, Binswanger dementia. So that is the important thing we have to keep in mind for intracerebral or intraparenchymal hemorrhage. This is the most common hemorrhage. This is the most common hemorrhage, and patient will be developing hypertensive encephalopathy, which will lead to the dementia, and that dementia is called as Binswanger dementia or Binswanger disease. So we have seen all these things, right, about hypertensive bleeding, intracerebral hemorrhage. Now, if we focus on the subarachnoid hemorrhage, most common cause is the trauma. Second most common cause is the Barry's aneurysm. Look at the language of the question. How examiner is asking, what is the most common cause of spontaneous subarachnoid hemorrhage? Spontaneous word is very, very important. If examiner says, what is the most common cause of spontaneous brain hemorrhage? So Barry's aneurysm is the most common cause of spontaneous subarachnoid hemorrhage. So if examiner is saying, what is the most common cause of spontaneous subarachnoid hemorrhage? So this word we have to be very careful during exam time. Most common cause of spontaneous subarachnoid hemorrhage, again your answer will be shifting towards the Barry's aneurysm, right? Barry's aneurysm, there will be defect in tunica media, right? So there will be defect in tunica media. So there will be a defective tunica media. So tunica media is defective in case of Barry's aneurysm. This is the important and controversial question, and there should be no controversy regarding this question, right? It is tunica media, muscle layer, which is defective in case of the Barry's aneurysm, right? In Barry's aneurysm, another important thing which examiner asks, because they involve circle of Willis, right? In circle of Willis, this is the most common site, right? So this circle of Willis is the site where you will see Barry's aneurysm, right? And what is the most common site? In circle of Willis, what will be the most common site? What will be the most common site for Barry's aneurysm? So that is the important MCQ which examiner asked. Most common site for Barry's aneurysm is the junction. Remember, it is the junction of anterior cerebral artery with anterior communicating branches. Anterior communicating branches, right? So junction of anterior cerebral artery and anterior communicating branches, right? So these are the most common sites. So junction of anterior cerebral artery and anterior communicating branches is the most common site for the Barry's aneurysm, right? because at this place narrowing of the lumen will be there, and they will be meeting at one junction, and this junction, because the lumen will be narrow, so flow of the blood will be faster, and this fast blood, when they will have impact at this junction where tunica media will be little deficit, they will cause damage and there will be swelling, or there will be the aneurysm formation, right? So this is the most common site because of the narrowing of the lumen, and impact of the blood flow will be very fast because lumen is smaller, so flow will be faster. Simple rule of physics, lumen is smaller, flow of the blood will be faster, and that is why damage will be more at this place. So on the same line, this was the All India question. What is the most common site of Barius aneurysm? Junction of anterior cerebral artery with anterior communicating branches. Now question will be framed like this. What will be the least common site? Now the question is, what is the least common site for Barius aneurysm? Least common site for Barius aneurysm. So what is the least common site? Least common site will be vertebral artery. This was the All India and AIIMS question in 2012, right? So vertebral artery is the least common site, and that was the question in older All India and AIIMS exam, right? So least common site is the vertebral artery for Barius aneurysm formation. Now there is an important thing which we have to understand. Barius aneurysm, we have seen the common site. What is the basic pathology in this? It's the congenital deficiency in the tunica media. But what we need to understand, is it associated with atherosclerosis? The question is, Barius aneurysm, is it associated with atherosclerosis? Answer is yes, it is. Always remember, it is associated with atherosclerosis also. So it is associated with atherosclerosis also. But it is rarely associated, right? So one of the rarest aneurysm associated with the atherosclerosis in the brain at the circle of Willis, right? So this point we have to keep in mind, because many people feel it is a congenital aneurysm. Yes, it is congenital aneurysm. Yes, it is congenital aneurysm, but it is associated with atherosclerosis also, right? So these are the important points about the brain hemorrhages